appealing. Everything that traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing that extra bow. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are alone. Yesterday they told you you would not go far. That night you opened and there you are. Next day on your dressing room they hung a star. Let's go on with the show. The costumes, the scenery, the makeup, the props. The audience that lifts you when you're down. The headaches, the heartaches, the backaches, the flops. The sheriff who escorts you out of town. The opening when your heart beats like a drum. The closing when the customers don't come. There's no business like show business, like no business I know. You get word before the show has started that your favorite uncle died at dawn. On top of that, your partner has parted. You're brokenhearted, but you go on. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are alone. Even with a turkey that you know will fold, you may be stranded out in the cold. Still, you wouldn't change it.
If you haven't been here before, we are an independent bookstore, so thank you for coming and supporting us in that. We're so excited to have Michael Anchorage here to talk about his new silent era book about Mae Murray. All of his work that he focuses on is about the silent era, and this is the newest one. So join me. Oh, cell phones. If we could silence our cell phones. Almost forgot that one. And now you can join me in welcoming Michael.
Thank you. Thank you all. So it's nice to see everyone here, and today Chris and I have been bumming around Hollywood. We went, and so you will see that, you know, we have dust all over us because we went around the Hollywood sign to the back to actually see what's back there. And so, and we looked for all things Mae Murray today. We went, we haven't gotten to her cemetery, you know, where she's buried yet, but we're gonna maybe do that this afternoon. And we've tracked down some of her homes, and so. Anyway, we've had a good time. I've had a good time since I've been out here. I came out Thursday from Georgia, and yesterday we had the opportunity to speak at the memorial service for Valentina, and that was quite an honor to be there. I have some special guests. Miles Kruger is here. Miles gave me the anecdote that I used for the opening of the book, and I may let him tell you about it when I'm finished introducing here. But I'm just going to talk a little bit about how I came upon Mae Murray as a subject and the difficulty that I had in putting her life together. And I'll read some passages from the book, and then I will entertain some questions that you all have, that you might have. So one of the questions I always get is, why Mae Murray? And I always say, why not Mae Murray? Because she was such a big star in her day. She was in all the different time periods of entertainment, stage, the cabarets, films, vaudeville, television, radio. She went through the gamut of entertainment. So, what an amazing career she had. But there's been so little that was known about her. I mean, she was a master at covering her own tracks, so that no one could know where she came from and, you know, where she was born, when. And so I call her one of the most controversial, misunderstood actresses of the silent screen. So when I begin questioning fellow writers about Mae Murray, they would say, you know, how can you write her when no one knows, you know, where she was born? And no one knows her birth certificate. That, you know, they don't know where, when she was born or anything. So how can you write a book? So I set out to, you know, dive into the weeds to find out where she was. You know, was it Portsmouth, Virginia? Or was it really that she was born on her father's yacht and they sailed around the world, like she always said? Uh-huh. Or was she more humble beginnings? And so it turns out that she was actually born in the Lower East Side of Manhattan in dismal poverty. Her father was an alcoholic, and he was a bartender, and he died when she was 12 years old. So she did not have the life that she often said that she did. So getting any kind of biographical information from her was very difficult, not only for me, but all the way back to the teens, you know, when she first started. This writer, Carol Lee, writing for Motion Picture Magazine in 17, found extracting biographical data from stage and film star Mae Murray akin to trying to chain butterflies. You know, trying to get anything out of her was like trying to chain butterflies. So to begin with, everything, or nearly everything that has been written about her is wrong. Delight Evans, writing for Photoplay, warned her readers in 1920. They say she is Irish. She isn't. They have said she cultivates persistently the mental attitude of a boarding school child who only went to a theater once or twice. And then it was to see Julia Marlowe and E.H. Southern in their Shakespeare repertoire. They say she has a perpetually innocent and injured expression with which she seems to say, "Where do babies come from?" But they're all wrong. Mae Murray was really born Mae somebody else. So all of the questions that they asked then, I asked, you know, when I started writing and researching this book 2 years ago. And so I am, you know, a persistent researcher. I never give up. I don't mind digging into the weeds to try to pull out, you know, the truth, or else I don't want to write the book. I'm skipping around here. So when she reached her teens and early adulthood, she kind of rewrote her whole history. She divorced her family, she divorced her past, and she didn't want to be reminded that she had two brothers, and didn't want anybody to know that her dismal circumstances. And, you know, even her son did not know anything about her family, and he didn't know where she was born or anything about her. So when she gave birth to Karan, her son, and he was an illegitimate son, she made clear to him that he would never know when or where he was born himself. So she kind of withheld that information from him as well. And so he was eventually adopted by another family. And so because he didn't know anything about his past, he's never had a birth certificate. He's never had a passport. He's never been able to travel anywhere out of the country. And the only thing he's been able to find was that he was born in Paris in about 1926, about 6 months before his, you know, supposedly parents were married. So Mae surrounded herself in a lot of secrecy and a very selective memory. She gave Jane Ardmore, who was her first biographer, I guess, in the late 50s, fits about stuff. And so Jane would say, "Well, okay, tell me about your first husband, William Swinker." And she would say, "Never heard of him." And that was it. End of conversation. You know, she would say, "End of," and that was it. And so in her mind, I think she really kind of with, you know, just withdrew from the truth a lot. So to begin to understand Mae Murray, one must realize that early on she created a fantasy world for herself. A world in which she wanted it to be. Okay? So to understand her complex nature, listen to an interview she gave in 1933. And at this time, you know, her career was on the skids, her personal life was on the skids, and she was, I think she really told the truth in this interview. And I think this is the key to understanding who she was. She said, "I am not a realist by nature, and for me to try to become one would only make me acutely unhappy," May explained. "All my life, I have tried to rise above external situations if they were unsatisfactory. And often they have been. Since I was 13 and first went on the stage, I have lived as much as possible in a world of fantasy, seeing only those things in life I have wanted to see, avoided the things which would pull me down and make me miserable. My dreams have always been a jump ahead of the interesting events which have befallen me. I think my dreams have actually made them possible. When grief has come to me, I have been able, because of the imaginary world I built for myself, to climb out of its reach mentally and to protect myself to the happy ending." So I think that gives us a clue as to who the real Mae Murray was. So Mae thrived in her career. I mean, she reached the top echelon of filmmaking. She thrived as long as she was allowed to live in her fantasy. And being married to a director, her business partner, Robert Z. Leonard, and he allowed her to rise to the top, and he kind of controlled her by letting her live in her fantasy world, both on the screen and off the screen. It was only when she was forced to face reality in a world on her own is when she began to fall apart professionally and personally. And without steady guidance from Leonard or anyone else with her interest at heart, she alienated herself by her outrageous outbursts and was blackballed by her boss, Louis B. Mayer. And in addition, she fell under the spell of a penniless prince. And you all know the name, the charming David Devaney. She said David. So he robbed her of her sanity and her fortune, which was $3 million, not too bad, in 1926. And with her film career on the skids in the late 20s, Mae embarked on a strenuous, vulnerable tour while her husband stayed back in Beverly Hills with their son and lived the life of a prince. So he was no longer a penniless prince. He had $3 million to spend. So listen to a portion of an interview that she gave in late 1928. "A tired and weary Mae Murray spent Christmas alone at the Sagamore Hotel in frigid Rochester, where she dazzled and excited crowds in the holiday spirit of the Rochester Theater. She spoke backstage about the sadness and regret over spending another Christmas without her son, who was 3,000 miles away in sunny California. Christmas without my little boy," Mae lamented, a tear rolling down her cheek. "It's just too awful if I let my thoughts go back to him too often." The actress, who had lived life in footlights and on marquees for over 20 years, caught hold of her emotions and stiffened her bee-stung lips. "But that's just part of life in the theater. Performers must entertain when the public wishes to be entertained. They must accept heartbreak with a smile." And that was my original title. That's what I thought would have been a good title for the book, Heartbreak with a Smile. But, you know, the publisher went out and it's called Mae Murray, the Girl with the Bee-Stung Lips. So I will entertain any questions. That's my brief introduction to the book. I don't know how many have read it. Miles, you've read it, right? You finished it?
Finished it at 5 this morning.
Yeah. And another one. So any questions that anybody has about Mae Murray or how I came about the book?
Has anybody done a DNA, a blood test of any kind to determine who the son's father is?
No, he's never given a DNA test to that. And it's doubtful at this time he will. I'm sure he must be interested, but at this point he's just kind of moved on with his life and he's happy. He's been married for over 60 years. He has two daughters and they're grown. He has a grandchild who is named Elizabeth May. And he doesn't really know exactly who his father is, although the pictures in the book of Daniel as a child look a lot like Devani. And so I think it's really probably, I suspect that May met the prince in Paris before they were married and then had the child there. But I don't know that. That's just, you know, as I researched and I've looked at passenger manifests, and you know, knowing the times that May was in Paris, and that he has the baptismal certificate that I've seen, that so I conclude that maybe he is the father, but born out of wedlock and then married. So,
what interested you in her enough to write a book about her?
The only thing that I knew about May was what I had read in The Self-Enchanted, and it was very fanciful. It was, you know, it has a lot of truth in it, but still a lot of it is made-up dialogue. And I was fascinated with her all the way from the 70s, because if you've seen the picture, it's in the book of her lying on the floor with this martini glass. And I think that's probably how I learned to love martinis, because I could drink out of one of those glasses like she had in that still. But there was so much unknown about her that I wanted a challenge, and she was it. And yet no one had written about, I mean, the truth about her, and there was so much to tell. Anyone else?
I had for years heard that she was born in Portsmouth. It's new to hear about Manhattan. Were you able to determine the year of her birth? I'd always seen 1895.
1895?
Yeah, when my first heard
Poor
May. Widow and that. Was she 1887?
1885. And by the end of her career, she had moved it to 1897, which would have made her six when she started on the stage, I guess. And it was funny, yesterday, I didn't tell the story yesterday, Tracy, at the memorial, but she always said that she was, you know, Rudy was always much older than I was. And, you know, he was 11 years younger. So, but of course he was not around to defend himself anymore, so.
Have you visited the Garden Court Apartments where she lived on the site of it on Hollywood Boulevard or Martel? I understand she lived in the 1400 block of North Martel.
Is the house still there on Martel?
No, it's an apartment building.
Okay. Well, maybe that's what we'll do later, Chris. Maybe we'll go see some of those homes. I think the house that Jack built, Jack Donovan, is still there, I think, on San Vicente.
Still standing?
I think so. On Google Maps,
from
I pulled up.
From the description in your book, it looks as though it's going to fall down any minute.
I know, yeah. But I did try, I tried to track down someone who lived, in the book I tell about, you know, when Hollywood almost lost its a girl with a beast on the lip. She had a stroke and they found her in an apartment on South Ardmore here. And so I was able to contact some of the residents who lived there at that time. But for some reason, they didn't have any memory of her. But I did try to, you know, leave no stone unturned in finding, you know, the most detail about her. Tracy.
Is there anything you left out of your book that through maybe just for sheer size, or maybe you didn't want to put it in to, is there something, any interesting tidbits that got left out?
I think I included everything that I wanted to tell that I could substantiate. But, you know, the two things that May has taken with her that I can't seem to find is whatever happened to her mother. I still have no idea what happened to her mother. You know, there was rumors that, of course, May's mother went to work for the Whitley family in New York, the Whitney family. After May's father died, and she worked in a mansion, and you know, with the Whitneys and all of that, and there was a rumor that she married one of the Whitney brothers, but I could never find that to be the truth.
But the Whitney family is so well documented.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's one. I don't think that was true. So we don't know what happened to her.
What was she, a housemaid or something?
Mm-hmm. Housemaid, May's mother.
Oh, that's
mm-hmm.
good.
Mm. And the other thing that I have never found out is exactly who David's father is. I mean, Daniel's father is, you know, the son. And I think at this point he's given up trying to find it.
David has grandchildren. Mm-hmm. I mean, the prince has children and grandchildren. Are they still living?
He had a son. He had another son, Michael, I think, who died. I don't know that. I don't think he had children.
You don't think Michael had children?
Mm-mm. And so he only had another son, who was Daniel. And Daniel has two daughters, so those are the grandchildren.
So David has the DNA.
Mm-hmm. If they were willing to.
For the sequel,
maybe.
The famous scene of everybody lunching at MGM in 1928 for Marion mm-hmm. Davies' Show People shows mm-hmm. Mae Murray mm-hmm. sitting there with yeah. his hat on. So she, I guess, was let back into MGM in 28 to do Show People. But she was out doing vaudeville in mm-hmm. 26 and 27.
Yeah, did you see the look on her face in that?
Very sad.
Very sour, sad.
Yeah, I'm wondering whether Louis B. Mayer forced her back in.
I think it was kind of telling that, you know, the look on her face in that scene. She looked very unhappy, very ill and out of place. And so, of course, by that time, she had already abandoned MGM to, you know, because she left and went to, you know, Germany and signed a contract with UFA. And then had to break it. And Louis B. Mayer said, "Do you realize if you do this?" Or, you know, Hearst, you know, William Randolph Hearst said, if you do this, you know, you're going to be blackballed. You'll never make another film." And so she had to go back and break it.
She might have done it to placate Mayer, try to get into his good graces.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so I know she was brought back to do several other films at MGM, and she probably, you know, was asked to do this little bit for. Show People. Anything else?
What did she do on television?
Sue, Miles, you may have to help me. She did some. She did some specials. You know, she would never, I don't think, turn down much. I mean, she did Ed Sullivan, and then you know, she would do early television where she could go in and do the Merry Widow. She would do the Merry Widow anywhere anybody asked her, I think. So those are the type. I mean, she wasn't in a sitcom or anything like that. It was just, you know, like a variety show or a special appearance.
Perhaps it was on local television shows before, you know, mm-hmm. and the networks mm-hmm. were starting. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. So Ed Sullivan was her network stuff. Maybe she did the locals.
Mm-hmm. So she liked to turn down jobs. She would say sometimes, she said, "Do you realize that I've just made," somebody would offer her, you know, so much money to appear on something that said $200 or something for a week, and she said, "Do you realize that I just made $5,000 on Ed Sullivan?" She said no, she would just turn things down. And so I think she was her own worst enemy a lot of times.
That she made 13 talking pictures.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can never quite believe what she said.
Mm-hmm. Anything.
I'm going to let Miles, if Miles doesn't mind, he gave me the first anecdote, as I said, about how he introduced her in 1960?
59.
And he actually knew May, and I was so honored to be able to use, to open the book with his anecdote. And if you don't mind sharing. The stage is yours.
I had a friend named Morty Gottlieb who became a successful Broadway producer, but before that he was the company manager of The Gazebo, which starred Walter Slezak and Jane Meadows on Broadway. And the show was playing at the Lyceum Theater for quite some time, and he asked me if I'd like to come and see it. So I was seated toward the rear and the left, and there was a woman sitting next to me and another one with whom she was talking. And the woman sitting next to me, I have to say, reeked from the most terrible perfume I can ever imagine. I mean, it's just, I can smell it today. And it was Friday night, March 20th, 1959. And she kept talking to this other woman, who turned out to be Jane Ardmore, her biographer, about the Merry Widow. And it was unclear to me who she was and what production she was talking about. I didn't know if it was a stage production or not. I never thought about the silent film. So, of course, I had to find out who she was. And I told her who I was, and she mentioned she was Mae Murray. But she couldn't say R's. She would say Mae, like that. And I found her fascinating, absolutely fascinating. I've never met anyone quite like it. I mean, it was like entering Alice's Wonderland to have a conversation with her, because you never knew what you were going to expect. And I had a radio program every week at the time called Opening Night on WBAI. It was the first program ever on the history of the American musical theater, and I wanted to do a whole hour about the Ziegfeld Follies. And Mae Murray was in the Follies of 08, 09, and 15. And so I thought, how wonderful I could have someone as far back as the Follies of 08 talking about the Follies. But I knew that if I didn't put everything I wanted to say into the introduction, we might never get back to any particular subject, because you never knew where the conversation would drift with Mae Murray. And so I kept asking her to pre-record the interview, and she kept putting it off and putting it off and putting it off until finally it was the day of the show, and it was live, and we were sitting in front of two microphones at the studio. It was no more than 5 minutes before airtime. And she said, "Now, how are you going to introduce me? How are you going to introduce me?" So I said, "Well, let me see." And I read it off the script. I said, "It is now my great pleasure to introduce Miss Mae Murray, a star of the Ziegfeld Follies," which she wasn't. She wasn't the star of it. She was featured in it. And whose most famous role was in the Erich von Stroheim film version of The Merry Widow, starring John Gilbert. "Oh, honey, oh, it's a good thing we talked about this ahead of time, because, you see, I shouldn't mention the Follies. It's too historical." The whole reason for her being there was to talk about the Follies, but it was too historical. So I had to cross out the Follies. "How does it read now?" So I said, "And Miss Mae Murray, whose most famous role was in the Erich von Stroheim song." "Oh, honey, oh, you have to take out Erich von Stroheim. Oh, he was an evil man. He was a terrible man. She couldn't say R. He did the most terrible things to me, and the most terrible things to the picture. Take him out." So out went Erich von Stroheim. "How does it read now?" So I had to read it. The most famous role was in the film version of The Merry Widow, starring John Gilbert. "Oh, no, honey, no. It didn't star John Gilbert. It was..." And she was reading it as if she was in the theater. "Mae Murray in The Merry Widow with John Gilbert." He was lucky he got billing. And so she said, It doesn't seem right now, does it?" I said, "Well, it does seem a little barren." So she said, "Good." And suddenly her voice changed, and she became a human being for 30 seconds. The only 30 seconds I ever knew her, when she sounded like a real human being. Her voice still being like a little fluttering butterfly without the ability to pronounce R's. And suddenly she said, "Why don't you write this?" So she dictated to me, word for word, what I read on the air, and I still have a tape of it. "It is now my great pleasure to introduce the Merry Widow of the silent screen, Miss Mae Murray." No one directed it. She did nothing else. No one was in it. There was no Prince Danilo. There was only Mae Murray. And that's the way she was. And we went to see, I arranged for the Museum of Modern Art to show The Merry Widow one time for her. We had a private screening. And the poor woman was wearing rags, really. And her skirt was being held by a very large, safety pin. And I didn't know where she wanted to go after the screening, but we walked to the corner of 53rd and 5th Avenue, and suddenly the safety pin opened and her skirt fell to the ground. And without batting an eyelash, as if it happened all the time, she just lifted her skirt, put it back on, and then went off. And she described to me how she went to, which hotel was it? St. Moritz, I think. Was it St. Moritz? No, it was one of the hotels on 5th Avenue. And she was having tea, and some elegant older gentleman recognized her and invited her to join her for lunch, and join him for lunch, and she was so touched by the fact, you see, honey, they still remember Mae Murray. She always took the opportunity to mention her name. She didn't say me. They remember Mae Murray. So those were some of the things. Then my friend Romano Tozzi, who lives in New York, got to know her quite well. And I lived in Greenwich Village at 25 East 10th Street and had a projector and a screen. So he got a 16mm print of the talkie version of her film, Peacock Alley. And we watched it together, and it was so fascinating. It was just like a scene out of Sunset Boulevard. And she's looking there at herself from 1929. And she kept commenting about herself, always in the third person. It was very interesting. And she kept saying, oh, couldn't she shouldn't have done that. She should have looked a little to the left. She did that well. She did that as if it was someone else. And I commented about it when the film was over. I said, Mae, you always refer to yourself in the third person. And she said, oh, honey, I'm not that person out on the screen. It's very interesting. It makes you really wonder about how different it is, I think, to be a performer in theater versus a performer in film. Because in film, your image remains permanent. Women hated the musical Gypsy. Mm-hmm. I used to see Gypsy over and over again because I knew the woman who was the house manager, and she just let me in anytime I wanted to see Gypsy with Ethel Merman. And women hated Gypsy. Why did they hate Gypsy, you might ask? But you didn't, but I'll tell you why. Because it's relevant to Mae Murray. Women grew up of a certain age with Ethel Merman. As she got older, they got older. They didn't see that they were getting older, therefore they didn't see that she was getting older. But suddenly, she plays a devil in Gypsy. And for the first time in their lives, they could see that maybe in themselves there is an element of the devil. Mm-hmm. And women felt personally betrayed by Ethel Merman's performance in Gypsy, which is one of the reasons it didn't run as long as it should have, and I think it's why she didn't get the Tony for doing it. But it's interesting, because you grow up on the stage with the person as the years go by. You're the favorite. I mean, I saw Barbara Cook when she was a kid, and I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And I've watched her get bigger in every sense of the word. and she's wonderful. But we all age the same way, but it doesn't happen with film. With film, the star is frozen at a particular time, and I think that has a very serious effect on the minds of many film performers, male and female.
Yeah.
Something to think about.
And I think Mae was, she would never say something to think about. So that was a great, I think, way to start the book, and I'm really thankful to Miles for that anecdote. So any more questions? And then... more questions, you can ask me back here if you want to. So, anyway, thank you all for coming.
Thank
it's been
you.
A pleasure.
Thank you for coming. If you need to get a copy of the book, we have them at the front, and then we're going to move to the back for the signing.
We'll be right back. fantastic.
Yeah.